Man, that song, whisper, whisper, whisper in my ear. You know, tell me things I thought I'd never hear. You know, illuminate what's right in front of me.
Yes.
Before something can be illuminated, it's got to be right in front of you. Right?
True.
You'll see why, and we're going down a path, son, that is going to be absolutely amazing today. I'm excited. I'm excited about this week. I'm excited about next week. And I'm already pumped up about Ruth. Because this week, son, we're going to get into some good stuff. Some really good stuff. Anyway, hi, Father. Let me recap real quick for you. Some notes. I want you to remember that word whisper, whisper, okay? You're going to hear that today. You're going to hear that word today. I want to make some connections. You guys got this right here. You guys know that there's no coincidence in God, right?
Amen.
All right. I want to correct some things. You guys got all of this already. I want to show you a couple little things real quick. God will connect some dots for you. If you understand the times and the seasons that you're living in, things right in front of you, He'll show some connections to. I want to show you a couple of connections real quick. And in these notes before we actually get started, but everybody knows what happened over there in Orlando, Florida, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. First thing, it was a tragedy. Okay. Now there's all kind of things going on, whether it was a hoax or it actually happened, you know, I don't know. And I'm not worried about all of that. But I wanted to show you something that, what was that, John?
You mean a hoax?
Mean whether it was another false flag set up, you know, something they just pulled off so they can take our guns away from us. Okay, that's, yeah, it's all over the YouTube now. Okay, I don't want to get into it. There's no call, I don't want to get into that. All right. If you want to find out more about it, you can go look it up. But I want to just show you some things that is like, wow. I'm more interested in the countdown from Sinai is Pentecost and when the Lord's going to return. That's what I want to show you. I want to show you some interesting connections. And the reason I'm connecting this today is because you're going to see it what we read today. And what we read today, which is absolutely amazing. Now, I've been telling you guys just real quick, and this is really not opening a message. We've been counting, you know, from the 17th day of Nisan, which is resurrection and the cross, right, to Pentecost, you know, and there's 49 days, right, the Feast of First Fruits, 49 days, and then the 50th day is Pentecost, right?
Amen, right?
That's what we've been talking about, the Feast of First Fruits. And I told you that this is called the counting of the Omer. Is that what I've been telling you guys? The counting of the Omer. Also, I told you guys that, and I want you to pay attention close. I told you guys that this is a harvest. This is the barley harvest. This is a harvest time that's going on. And the wheat harvest begins on Pentecost.
Amen.
Right? Check this out. Now, I don't know if it has any connection or not, but it just so happens that Pentecost this year fell on the 12th, right? Last week was Pentecost.
Amen.
Okay? And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. So last week was Pentecost, the 50th day, right? So let's look at the stats of what happened in Orlando. It says that 50 was killed. Hold on. Right?
Yeah.
Hold on. Okay, hold on. Right. 50 was killed and 53 was wounded. Actually, if you want me to do it correctly, 49 was killed plus the man, which makes 50. And 50 is the number of Pentecost. Y'all with me on that?
Yes. Amen.
All right. Now.
Yeah. Amen.
Now watch this. Check this out. The cops killed him on Pentecost, which made 50. He killed 49 people. And 49 is the number of the Omer. And his name was Omar.
Oh no.
The counting of the Omar, he harvested 49 bodies. And he was killed on Pentecost. That's exactly right. Does the 50 and 3 have any significance?
Yes.
Oh, yes, it does. Oh, yes, it does. And you're going to see it today. Why is 50? We know 50, and biblically, it says 50 and 3. That's how they would write it in the Bible, right? 50 and 3. We know 50 is Pentecost. What is this and 3? We're going to find out. What is this right here? I want to say something else. Sodom and Gomorrah was judged on Pentecost.
Wow.
There was a Sodomite club on Pentecost was judged. Did God do it? No. God did not do it.
This all happened on Pentecost.
It's all on Pentecost. Did God do it? No, he did not. How do I know that? Because his word says that there is a day that is reserved for judgment.
Right.
A day when he will judge. But you know what? The enemy knows the feasts and the festivals that God operates in. And they move in it. So let's go. This was brought to me Saturday on Pentecost. I'm going to show you some. When you start taking notice of things that are around you, they was in the upper room, remember, on a day of Pentecost.
Amen.
We got a call to go, you know, to meet another sister in the Lord whose husband was killed on Pentecost. Tragic. Anybody ever says that, you know, with these, God hates sin, not the people. Understand?
Yeah.
Would it be praying for people?
Right.
Having compassion. That's Jesus, a heart of compassion. I don't agree with what they're doing, but we're to love people.
That's right.
And hopefully, through love, they'll be pulled out of what they're doing. They'll see the compassion. I've already seen some things that are going on that, you know, is absolutely crazy out there. There's people saying it's good that happened to them and all of this kind of stuff. You know, these are the things that God said would happen in the last days. Okay? We're to love people, not judge them.
Right?
This all happened on Pentecost. There was a harvest. There was judgment. Right? I don't find it a coincidence that I get a phone call and a friend of ours was just so happened, you know, to come home off of vacation, and you know, a brother goes up in an upper room on Pentecost.
Oh no.
In the attic.
In
And fire shoots through him. Fire came down on Pentecost. He was in an upper room. You know, what's going on? I don't know. Did God judge him? No, indeed not. No, indeed not. But it was something that came to me, and I realized the times and the seasons that we're in, and you know, you start connecting dots. Illuminate, what's right in front of me. You start seeing things. But let me tell you something. The only way that God can illuminate things to you is you have to be in your Word. You have to have the Word in you. You can't search the computer if there's no information in it. That's why Peter only wrote two books. And he was like the apostle that, you know, now we know it was built on Jesus Christ, but they got the elevation of Peter. Peter only wrote two because he was unlearned.
Amen.
Right? He was unlearned. But Peter wrote 13, we know, I mean, Paul wrote 13, we know for sure, but we think 14 possibly. Why? Because he was learned. So what's going to happen with Paul? Paul's going to be able to connect a whole lot more dots. Illuminate, what's right in front of me. Whisper in my ear. That's the Lord. The Bible says the Lord speaks from behind you, telling you to go here and go this way and that way in Psalms. Right? So I just wanted to make a connection. So today I want you to remember this three, and I want you to remember whisper as we get into this. Pentecost, what is it? I told you in the very beginning, and I'm going to read them to you again. We're about to have some fun. Because it's all going to be like, wow. It's just going to open up to you. Y'all ready? You got your Bibles?
Yeah.
All right. I told you guys to read Ruth. Right? We're gonna open up Ruth in a whole new way. In an amazing way. But if you haven't, I'm going to make a few connections for you, just a little quick tidbit. Ruth went to Boaz where? The threshing floor, right? To be what? What did she want? She was looking to be covered for married, to be married, right? What time of night did she go?
Midnight.
Wow, midnight. Does that kind of sound like something in Matthew chapter 25 with the parable of the 10 virgins?
Amen.
And a call went out at midnight? Wow. Does that sound familiar? Wait, there's another midnight. Remember Paul and Silas were singing in the jail? And at midnight there was a great sound and a thunder and a great earthquake. Can all of this tie together? Man. I want to tell you something. Zola Levitt just put out an article about how Pentecost this year actually falls on the 19th. Remember I told y'all that it's this year it's fallen between the 12th and the 19th this week. You know, we don't really know, because you're going to find out that tomorrow night, check this out. And he goes on to explain in great detail also that June 20th, so this would be Monday, early, you know, Monday or Sunday night, is the full moon. Okay? Right? You know what that moon is called? The strawberry moon. It's where we get the word honeymoon from.
Does that mean you're going to Tennessee?
Does Pentecost? So, now, let me take it a step further. Does Pentecost, could it be a possibility that Pentecost speaks about marriage? Yes, it does. Do you want to know what song they sing on this day? Swing low, sweet chariot. No, wait, hold on. How's it go? Wait, hold on. Man, I was just singing it. Hold on. Hold on now, I'm gonna get it. I was gonna go and sing into another song because I had mixed these songs and I should have never done that. How's it go? It's Elijah. when the chariot's coming down.
No,
what?
I was thinking the abortion.
No, it's No. Wait, Lord, Father, please. It'll come to me. And I'm doing this thing. I'm going to sing you that song. And I'm not a singer. I don't profess to be a singer, but I'm going to sing that song to you. All right. You guys ready? It's also called the Strawberry Moon. This also falls on Father's Day. And I don't think it's by any chance. So let's get started. You guys are in for a ride. I'm telling you. All right. I'm going to do a quick review, just really fast. 4 weeks ago, we started talking about between Passover and Pentecost, understanding God in a deeper and more powerful way, right? You want to understand God in a deeper and more powerful way? I know I do. And I talked about how Egypt to Mount Sinai was the same time as Mount Sinai to Kadesh Barnea and Joshua to Jericho and Jesus to the upper room in Pentecost. And I connected all kind of stuff there. 3 weeks ago, we started talking about the counting of the Omer, the 7 weeks of seven between first fruits and Pentecost. And we found out that the Hebrew word for sheaf is Omer. And Omer is a tenth part of the first fruits harvest. And Christ was the first fruits of the resurrection. And he was the first in everything. And then those that are his at his coming. So we found out that the barley harvest is for 49 days. Pentecost is the beginning of the wheat harvest. That's when the wheat harvest starts. Okay, and then I talked about the following week how Pentecost is the culmination of the counting of the Omer, the 49 days that lasted for 49 days. It finds its conclusion on Shavuot or Pentecost, where it really, really all begins. And I'm trying to show that Pentecost is when is the day that Jesus returns, okay? It's when he returns. Man, that's two of my most favorite people. Come on in. Come on.
Look,
come on, give me a hug. Good to see you. Good to see you, Charlie.
You had an episode.
It's all good. Good to see you, Carol. All right. So, we're just starting too. You need a seat to sit down, Carol? All right. So, all right, guys. All right. Then I gave you that countdown to Sinai. The countdown to Mount Sinai is the countdown to seeing him face to face, right?
Amen.
The countdown to Mount Sinai is the countdown of his coming. That's when he came down, right? The countdown to Mount Sinai is the countdown to the marriage. That's Pentecost. That's when God married the children of Israel, and I gave y'all some scriptures on that. The next thing I had was the countdown to Mount Sinai is a countdown to Judgment Day. That's when it begins. The next one was the countdown to Mount Sinai is the secret that unlocks the mystery for Yeshua returning for his bride. And the last one was the countdown to Mount Sinai is Pentecost, and Peter gives us the key to unlock its ministry, its mystery. That's where I'm going. I'm going to the last one because this is the order how it fell out with me, you know, in my progress of going forth. It was the best to do it like this. So the countdown to Mount Sinai is Pentecost. We all know that. We can agree with that. And listen, we don't have to agree on everything. That's what makes us so unique, you know? That's what's good. The countdown to Mount Sinai is Pentecost. And you know what that means? That means that it's a possibility that tomorrow Jesus could come. Wow, you ready? I know y'all. I know you're ready. It's a possibility that Jesus could come because he comes on Pentecost. And I'm going to show that. And there might be some differences, but I'm going to show you something in here that's going to... Let me just keep going. All right, so let's dive into this. All right. All right, Lord, here we go. So the countdown to Mount Sinai is Pentecost. And Peter gives us the key to unlocking its mystery. What mystery? So Father, in Jesus' name, by your Holy Spirit, Lord, Lord, just speak to us, Lord. Reveal to us, Lord, your word. We're friends. And you said to Abraham, shall I hide from Abraham what it is that I'm about to do? Your word says that you reveal it to your servants, the prophets. Father, and that's who we are, Father. We are called to prophesy and preach your word. We're your children. We're your friends. You no longer call us servants, but we serve you. And you reveal unto your friends the secret things. So illuminate what's right in front of us, Lord.
Yes.
In Jesus' name.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen and amen. All right. I got right here. I was going to go another way, but the Lord had led me here, and this absolutely just floored me. Jesus had taken his disciples to this location for a reason, and I'm going to tell you where it's at. This is going to be in Matthew chapter 17. This is the Transfiguration. Matthew chapter 17. Okay? It says, Jesus had taken his disciples to this location for a reason. It was here that he was going to reveal who he was and on what day he would return. Let's read and make the connection. God truly is amazing. So we're going to go to Matthew chapter 17. We're actually going to start in Matthew chapter 16 because of some things that he says. Let me get to it and I'll tell you the scripture. All right, Matthew, in Matthew chapter 16, I'm going to start in verse 24, okay? Because I want to read into it. Wait. No, I'm sorry. We're going to start reading in 13, okay? And I'm going to start connecting because everything that happens is for a reason. And I'm going to show you.
13 or chapter 13?
Matthew chapter 16, verse 13.
Okay.
16:13. Y'all ready?
Yeah.
Watch this. Illuminate what's right in front of me. Let's go. When Jesus came into the coasts of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that the Son of Man am? And they said, some say that thou art John the Baptist, and some say Elias, and others Jeremiah, or one of those prophets. And he saith unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God.
Amen.
Okay. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah. So that's hearing. Bar-Jonah is the son of John, and Jonah means son of the Spirit. His name, this is right where he has his name changed. So this is a name-changing time, okay? Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed this unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. So let me connect the dot. God came down on Pentecost and revealed to people who Jesus Christ was. That's when they received power to be able to interpret the law with authority, to be able to interpret, to say and show. So Peter right here has received information which is actually going to be a point in which will connect you to Pentecost. And I'm going to show you how. Watch this. Next verse. And I say unto thee that thou art Peter. Right there. Bam. Changed his name. Right? Now, when did God come down? God came down on Mount Sinai. Right? and spoke to the people. God tells Peter, Jesus tells Peter, flesh and blood hadn't revealed this to you, but my Father, which is in heaven, revealed this. God spoke to the children of Israel when he came down on Mount Sinai, the great mountain, stone mountain. Remember, he charred. So, and I say unto thee, thou art Peter, I'm changing your name. Why did he change his name? And upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Peter's name becomes a piece or a chip of the rock. What rock? Mount Sinai, where God came down and revealed to the children of Israel. He's connecting Peter to Mount Sinai. That's why he named him a piece of the rock. Oh, y'all with me on that?
Yeah.
That's because they do things for a reason. Because he heard from heaven. When did they hear from heaven? At Sinai. So Jesus changes his name to when the people had heard from God on Sinai, and that's a rock, the stone. The law was written in stone, right? So, and he says, he's holding up a stone.
That's what he came to church with.
Wow. And he says, and it says, and I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Okay? And I will give unto thee keys, the keys of the kingdom. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. And then he charged his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus, the Christ, the anointed one. That means the Messiah. Okay? So now he says, don't tell nobody. Jesus just made a connection with Peter to Mount Sinai. And I'm going to go on and prove it to you. Watch this. Now go down. Verse 24. Right after that, he's got to rebuke Peter. You know, Peter thought he was something. Then Jesus says, let me just read it. From that time forth, Jesus began to show unto his disciples how he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things, and the elders and the priests and the scribes, and that he must be killed and raised again on the third day. Right? Remember the threes we had talked about. All right. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, but it be far from me, Lord, this shall not be done unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things of God, but of men. This is the flesh. He's thinking out of the flesh. Okay. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, that's your body, and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake will find it. For what is it a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Next verse. Listen, which is amazing. Now, the connection to Pentecost, he just changed Peter's name. Now he goes right into about his coming. Wow. Right? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father. When did the Father come down? Pentecost. Wow. With his angels. And then he shall reward every man according to his works. The Bible says in Revelations that when the Lord returns, his reward is with him. Wow. Revelation to reveal that day of his coming. Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. What? How can that be? Right? We know it's going to be thousands of years later, 2,000 years later before he comes. Look at the next, look what he says next. So he's specifically talking about his coming, and I told you guys this before. You're going to know this part, but I'm going to make a connection for you. After 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up unto a high mountain apart. That mountain he brought them to was Mount Hermon. Okay? That was Mount Hermon. And you can, that's where Mount Hermon, that's where the gates of hell will not prevail against them. Jesus is set, bringing them to a place. When he said, and the gates of hell will not prevail, why did he say that? Because it was on Mount Hermon where the sons of God came down and took the daughters of men. They came down on Mount Hermon. Jesus wanting to show when he is going to come down. Waited 6 days, which is symbolic, a day to 1,000 years. After 6,000 years, he's going to come down. He went to the place where the sons of God came down. So it's all about his coming. Because the Bible says in Noah's day, remember, Jared, his name was named Jared because Jared's name means to descend. For in his day is when the sons of God came down. He's connecting right here, right?
Yeah.
Jared, right? Jared, whose name means descending or to descend, gave birth to Enoch. Enoch was born on Pentecost. He was taken to heaven on Pentecost. Jesus is making a connection here. If it's not clear yet, it's gonna be, I promise you. Let's keep reading. So he taketh them to a high mountain, and he was transfigured before them. Right?
Come on.
And his face did shine like the sun, and his raiment was white as the light. This is a picture of his second coming. So when is his second coming going to be? Well, he's already connected it in Matthew chapter 16, right? When it's going to be. But if it's not clear yet, we're going to clear it up when we go a little bit further. It's on Pentecost. Watch this. And he was transfigured, he means changed, before them. And his face did shine as the sun. Does that kind of sound familiar? Who else's face shone like the sun? Moses. Oh, okay. Different mountain, I'm going to show you. And his remnant was white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah. Wow. Right there, you can write in your book right there, the Moses-Elijah connection. Mm-hmm. I'm going to connect the Moses-Elijah connection. And it's not what you think. I done revealed Moses and Joshua, Elijah and Elisha, and Jesus and John the Baptist, how they were all God the Father and the Son, which got into another one. But check this out. Look at this. Look at the next verse. Then answered Peter. Then answered Peter and said unto Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make 3 tabernacles. Where was the tabernacle built at? Mount Sinai. Wow. God came down on Pentecost and gave Moses exactly how to build the tabernacle. They was at Mount Sinai. Right?
Yeah.
So Jesus is making a direct connection. He's talking about his return, and he keeps bringing us back to the tabernacle, Mount Sinai. Pentecost. Watch. Boy, you talk about, you guys are in for it.
Mm.
So, he says, Then answered Peter and said unto Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us here make 3 tabernacles. One for thee, one for you, one for Moses. He had one already. And one for Elijah. Peter, thinking out of the flesh, he's wanting to set up another holy place. Wants to build a temple up there. Right? That would be man. God came right here. Spoke to me. Man, I'm going to make it an altar. make it a holy place, right? This is it. What God's wanting to do, though. While he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. Oh, where did the cloud come down? Where did the cloud come down? When? On Pentecost. Overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud. When did they hear a voice?
Pentecost.
Mount Sinai. That's right. Which said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him." So now, hear ye him. So now Jesus has all power and all authority, even over Moses and even over Elijah.
That's right.
God said to Peter, James, and John, with Moses and Elijah standing right next to him, "This is my beloved Son." These two here were prophets, and he is a prophet. But hear ye him. Exaltation.
Yeah.
He was raised up.
Yeah.
Right? Watch. Ooh, you guys are in for it. You guys are in for it. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and they were sore afraid. When were they afraid? At Pentecost on Mount Sinai. Remember that? They were afraid. And Jesus came and touched them and said, "Arise and be not afraid." And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Jesus. And as they came down from the mountain, go wait in the upper room on top of the mountain till you be endued with power from on high.
Amen.
Right? You always go up on a mountain to Pentecost. That's when they go. Jesus charged them, saying, "Tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man is risen from the dead." So as soon as he's raised from the dead, you can tell them what you saw. They should be able to connect Pentecost. Right? The Mount of Transfiguration and Moses and the Elijah connection. Why did Moses and Elijah appear to Jesus? Because Jesus was establishing when his coming was going to be. He told it right there in chapter 16, verse 27, "For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father and with his angels." He's going to show us when the day is going to be. So now, two people appear to Jesus. We know beyond the shadow of a doubt when God came down and spoke to Moses, right? The Moses-Elijah connection. Let's just look at a couple of them. And you probably might know this. There's three people in the Bible that fasted 40 days. Moses, Elijah, and Jesus.
Amen.
Yep.
There are three people that was on Mount Sinai, Mount Horeb, Mount Sinai. Moses, Elijah, and Jesus. Mm-hmm. How do I know that? Because he wrote the law with his finger. Let me show the adulterous woman. But what do you say? The law says she's to be put to death. And with his finger. God wrote the law with his finger. And it says in Luke, and with his finger, he showed him his finger. He began to stoop down and he wrote. Yeah, I remember when I wrote it. Three people on the mount. Woo! I'm bringing you back to Mount Sinai. All of them fasted 40 days and they was on the mount, right? So now, if what I'm telling you is true, and God's word says, "Let everything be established by two or three witnesses," then I ought to be able to connect Elijah. I ought to be able to connect Elijah and show how Elijah points to Pentecost. Beyond the shadow of a doubt. Beyond the shadow of a doubt. So you ready? Let's go. We're going to start. This is going to be good. I'm going to take, you can write this scripture down. In 1 Kings chapter 19 is where, and I'm going to connect a quick dot for you really fast. The Bible says that Elijah must come before the great notable day of the Lord's return. Right? When Elijah had came and talked to Ahab, there was a great famine in the land. So before Jesus Christ comes back, there's going to be a great famine. Whoa. Okay? Right? That was one of the, you know, prophetic symbolisms of the return of the Lord. There'd be a great famine. Elijah comes on the scene and he tells one of the servants, go tell Ahab, you know, that I'm coming. Right? And Elijah goes from 1 Kings chapter 17 to 1 Kings chapter 19. He comes in and he talks about, okay, if God is God, serve him. If Baal is God, then serve him. Right?
Amen.
So Jezebel's prophets were 450, and there was another 400. There was actually a total of 850 prophets, and you can read that. Okay? So he goes up on the mountain and builds an altar. Right? Long story short, you know, they build an altar and they sacrifice to their God. Elijah starts, you know, cry a little louder. Maybe your God's sleeping. You know, maybe this. There's, you know, now let's talk about now. There's 850 prophets there, right? They're on Mount Carmel. Oh, you guys are in for a ride today. That Mount Carmel. So, during the evening sacrifice, man, that's kind of... After they had cried out, all of these guys, with no answer, Elijah says, maybe he's sleeping. Maybe he's on vacation. Scream a little louder. They begin to cut themselves so they begin to gush out and lay on the altar. They try to get something to happen. And after all of that, Elijah said, okay, you see that altar right there? Not that same altar. Rebuild that altar, that altar for the Lord right there. And they built this altar. And he, at the time of the sacrifice, very important, he lays it out. And Elijah calls out to God. And he says, you can read it. He poured water on it a couple of times and drenched it. And God, our God is a consuming fire, right? And God answered by fire.
Amen.
Now, when does fire come down?
Pentecost.
Woo! Oh, interesting time. Something's going on here. Right? The Bible says that we are to, you know, be a living sacrifice.
Amen.
The burning bush fire descended on and it didn't burn, remember? We're the sacrifice that the fire sits on, but we're not consumed. We're not burnt, but we're consumed. I'm consumed, I can tell you that. Interesting time. So now Elijah says, grab them all. And on Mount Carmel, at the top, I was standing at March 13, 2006. And I'm going to connect this dot for you in a little bit. Elijah cuts off all the heads of the prophets. And that was the day of judgment. The heads rolled down the mountain. Wow. Okay? So, now we're going to pick up. Interesting day. Now, I want you to go. Now, we are going to have some fun. Now, I want you to go to 2 Kings chapter 1. You can go into the story of Elijah. It is absolutely amazing. Wow. Read it many times. 2 Kings chapter 1. The Moses-Elijah connection. Jesus is establishing a day of his return. Watch this, and I'm going to read. 2 Kings chapter 1. Man, I love this. I love to read and get in there and just, man, just God start whispering in my ear. This is what happened. This is the first time I've ever done this with Moses and Elijah with Pentecost. These guys that's been here has never heard. This is new revelation. Watch this right here. Then Moab rebelled against Israel after the death of Ahab, right? And Ahijah fell down through the lattice in his upper chamber. So he was up there in the upper chamber. Kind of interesting. That was in Samaria, and he was sick. And sent his messages and said unto them, go and inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron. That's the Philistine god. That would be Beelzebub, would be Lucifer or Satan, Baal, whether I shall recover of this disease. But the angel of the Lord said to Elijah, Elijah's name means Yahweh is God, the Tishbite, arise, go up to meet the messengers of the king of Samaria. Arise and go up. Okay, I'm going up. And say unto them, is it not because there is not a God in Israel that ye go to inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron? You know, are you... Isn't there a God in Israel that you can be asking him whether you're going to die or not instead of going to ask some false God? Let's keep reading. Now therefore, thus saith the Lord, Yahweh. That word Lord is Baal, landowner. The original, and it says that in the front of your King James. You'll see it. Thus saith... Now therefore thus saith the Lord Yahweh, thou shalt, or Jesus, thou shalt not come down from that bed on which thou art gone up, but shalt surely die. And Elijah departed. And when the messengers turned back unto him, he said unto them, why are ye now turned back? Kings wanting to know. And they said unto him, there came a man up to meet us, and said unto us, go and turn again unto the king that sent you, and say unto him, thus saith the Lord Yahweh, is it not because there is not a God in Israel that thou sendest to inquire of Beelzebub or Beelzebub? That just means the devil. That's all that means. The god of Ekron, therefore thou shalt not come down from that bed on which thou art gone up, but thou shalt surely die. So the king sends the servants to go inquire. The servants run into this man and they go back. You know, this man tells them, and these servants go back and tell the king who fell through the lattice. Next. And he said unto them, what manner of man was he which came up to meet you and told you these words? And they answered him, he was an hairy man and girt with a girdle of leather about his loins. And that king knew that it was Elijah the Tishbite. And instead of going to ask a man of God that he knew about, he was going to inquire of a soothsayer or a tarot card reader.
Amen.
Or from a false god whether he was going to live or die. Right? Does the hairy man in a girt with a girdle, leather about his loins, ring any bells? John the Baptist. Let's keep reading. Then the king sent unto him, hold on, get your pencils out and take notice. What is this day? This is the day of judgment. Then the king sent unto him a captain of 50 with his 50. So the captain of 50 men went out there. The captain with his 50 men. A captain of 50, of the 50, I'm sorry. So 49 with his 50. That's 50 men. Am I saying that right, guys? Okay. 50 is what? Pentecost. And he went up to him. Where did they go? And then the king sent unto him a captain, sent unto Elijah, a captain of 50 with his 50. And he went up to him, and behold, he sat on the top of the hill. And he spake unto him, thou man of God. He's on top of a hill calling Elijah a man of God. The king hath said, come down. Where do we see that word come down at? Mount Sinai. God comes down on Mount Sinai. How did God descend on Mount Sinai? Fire. Next verse. And Elijah answered and said to the captain of 50, if I be a man of God, then let fire come down from heaven and consume thee and thy 50. The Moses-Elijah connection. Wow. Still not convinced? Hold on. Back up. Illuminate what's right in front of us, huh? And consume thee and thy 50. And there came down fire from heaven and consumed him and his 50. That was judgment. Again, also, he sent unto him another captain of 50 with his 50. Let me, why couldn't it have been 30? Then it won't fit. Right? If it was 20 or 30 or 60, it don't fit. But it's 50. Jesus himself is pointing to his coming, and who does he put in front of him? Moses and Elijah. Precious. Again, he sent unto him another 50 with his 50, and answered and said unto him, O man of God, thus hath the king said, come down quickly. And Elijah answered and said unto them. Now I want to stop right there. Jesus said, I only do what I see my Father do. That means he operates through the feast and the festivals of the Lord. When they talking about the bread, he walks in and says, I'm the bread. When they talking about the light, he walks in and says, I am the light. And it goes on and on.
Amen.
Right? That's how he operates in his feast and festivals. Right? This is a day that fire can come down from heaven. Because this is the day. If I be a man of God, it just so happens to be it's Pentecost. Then I can call down fire from heaven on you and pronounce judgment on you. If I be a man of God, let fire come down and consume you. Whoa! Son. Good, what you said? Now the first 250 didn't learn anything. Right? Let's look at the next set of 50 that goes up there. Look at this. Watch this. Let's look at the next set of 50 men that go up there. And he sent again a captain of a third 50 with his 50. Now, I can go off on a tangent right here because 50 and 50 and 50 is, you know, no, I need to just stop. I'm going to stop. And the third captain of the 50 went up and came. Look at the difference. and fell on his knees in humility before Elijah and besought him, watch, and said unto him, O man of God, I pray thee, let my life and the life of these 50. Wow. He became, what did he do? He became a mediator, an advocate. What is that what you say?
Yeah.
Between him and the men.
Mm-hmm.
Let my life be precious in thy sight. Right? And these 50 servants, right? You know what's absolutely amazing about this? Because on this very day, God sent his law down at Sinai and 3,000 were killed. And on the very same day of judgment, right, the Holy Spirit came down and found grace and 3,000 were saved, added to the church. See? Humility. So, let's go. Behold, there came fire down from heaven, he said, and burnt up the two captains of the former 50s with their 50s. Therefore, let my life now be precious in thy sight. And the angel of the Lord said unto Elijah, go down with him, be not afraid of him. And he arose and went down with him unto the king. And he said unto him, thus saith the Lord, forasmuch as thou hast sent messengers to inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron, is it not because there is no god in Israel to inquire of his word? Question mark. Therefore, thou shalt not come down off of the bed on which thou art gone up, but thou shalt surely die. So he died according to the word of the Lord which Elijah had spoken, and Jeroboam reigned in his stead in the second year of Jeroboam, the son of Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat, king of Judah. Jehoshaphat means Jehovah will judge, the God of judgment, the king of Judah, because he had no son. Go ahead. Now the rest of the acts of Ahaziah, which he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of Israel? And it came to pass when the Lord would take up Elijah. Now time passed. Written, watch. Now the rest of the acts of Ahaziah, whatever, which he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the Kings of Israel? That ends the time. Watch. And it came to pass when the Lord would take up Elijah, wow, unto heaven by a whirlwind, wow, right? The Holy Spirit described as a whirlwind, that Elijah went with Elisha from Gilgal, right? So watch this. So Elijah's name means Yahweh is God, and Elisha's name means Yahweh is salvation. Watch this. And Elijah said unto Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord hath sent me to Bethel, right? And Elisha said unto him, as the Lord liveth and thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they went down to Bethel, which means house of God, right? And the sons of the prophets that were at the house of God came forth to Elijah, the sons of the prophets, watch this, and said unto him, knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? When did the people begin to prophesy?
On Pentecost.
The prophets are prophesying Elijah is going to be taken away. Wow. Huh? Amazing. Amazing. And Elisha said unto him, Knowest, and they came forth, let's see, and the sons of the prophets that were at Bethel, which is the house, came forth to Elisha, and said unto him, Knowest thou that the Lord will take away the master from thy head today? And he said, Yea, I know it. Hold thy peace. How does the prophets know that Elijah is going to be taken away on that day?
It was revealed to him.
That's right.
They knew the word.
That's very good.
What? I didn't hear what you said.
Can't hear what you said.
She said because it was Schaubhut, which was Pentecost. And Elijah, the prophets are prophesying that it was forespoken that Elijah would be taken away. Elijah just had appointed Elisha, you know, to reign in his stead, because he's going to be taken away. How does the prophets know that he's going to be taken up to heaven on that day? Because that's the day when God comes down. That's the day. And they know it.
That's right.
Let's see if it gets any clearer for us. Watch this. And Elijah said unto him, Elisha, tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord hath sent me to Jericho. And he said, As the Lord liveth, and thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. So they came to Jericho. And I'm not going to go off on a tangent. And the sons of the prophets that were at Jericho came to Elisha and said unto him, Knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today? That's a decapitation. That's a separation from the head, right? Watch. And he answered, Yea, I know it. Hold your peace. Watch this. This is so amazing. And Elijah said unto him, Tarry, I pray thee, here, for the Lord hath sent me to the Jordan. And he said, As the Lord liveth, and thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. And they two went on. Stop. This Jordan place right here is where Joshua crossed the Jordan and put the 12 stones in. Remember that?
Yeah.
Moses and Joshua. Remember that? They put the 12 stones in.
Yeah.
They just left Jericho, the first city they took on Pentecost. Remember I told you how Rahab was taken out of the city on Pentecost and all of that? Check this out. And Elijah said unto him, go ahead to the next one. Oh, you gotta be kidding me.
Yeah.
You gotta be kidding me. Is that true?
Yeah.
And 50 men of the sons of the prophets went. 50. Why? Yep, that's 50. And look at this. And stood to view afar off. And they too stood by the Jordan. The prophets knew on what day the Lord comes down. Right?
Yeah.
These prophets know that when God comes down, he descends in fire, son. So they are afraid and they standing afar away.
Yeah.
I'm going to check this out, but I ain't getting too close because I don't want to be burnt up. Wow. This is all a picture of the Lord coming.
Right.
You understand that?
Yeah.
The very day he's coming. Watch. It's not even questionable. It's too point blank. And Elijah took off his mantle and wrapped it together. And he smote the waters, and they were divided hither and thither, so that they too went over on dry ground. The last time that happened, is when Joshua, whose name means Jesus, was entering into the promised land after the 40 years in the wilderness with the children of Israel, about to gain their inheritance, the Jordan parted. That connection right there, that parting of the Jordan, is bringing you back to Joshua when the Jordan parted. Elisha's name means Jesus. Joshua's name means Jesus. And the parting of the Jordan, when they talk about it, brings you back to Moses when he parted the Red Sea. Yeah. And it's all about leaving Egypt, son.
Amen.
Go and inherit our promise. On our way to seeing him face to face. And Elijah took off his mantle and wrapped it together and smote the waters, and they were divided hither and thither, so that the two went over on dry ground. There was an altar of 12 stones right there. I'm sure probably when they was walking across, probably Elisha probably just stood on top of it. Hey, y'all, and just went over, you know, because it meant something. And it came to pass when they were gone over that Elijah said unto Elisha, ask what I shall do for thee. Ask what I shall do for thee before I be taken away from thee on Pentecost. And Elisha said, I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit. What? Wait. Let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. When did the Holy Spirit come down?
Pentecost.
Elisha's asking for the Spirit to be upon him, right? But he's actually asking for a double portion. Who received the double portion in the Israeli houses in those days?
Firstborn.
The firstborn. He was asking for the rights of the firstborn son. Let a double portion. Let me be a son. And let your spirit, the impartation of your spirit, be upon me. Yes, watch. It gets better. Watch. The importance of knowing then. And he said, thou hast asked a hard thing. Wow. We know that Elisha is a picture of Yeshua, Jesus. And he was the first begotten of the Father. And the firstborn always received a double portion. Always. That's in your Bible. Nevertheless, he says, if thou see me when I am taken up from thee, it shall be so unto thee. But if not, it shall not be so. And it came to pass, as they still went on. Now, they just crossed the Jordan. They are on the other side of the Jordan now, where Moses and Joshua would be. Where Moses laid hands on Joshua and imparted the Spirit into Joshua. This would be where John the Baptist is standing on the other side of the Jordan. John the Baptist is standing on the other side of the Jordan where Jesus came to him, where he received the Spirit. And it came to pass as they still went on and they talked, so they started walking off. There appeared a chariot of fire. It's Pentecost, baby, and you know the Lord's coming down with fire. And the horses of fire, and parted them both asunder. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. Now, remember I told you, and you stay where you're at, but I'm going to read something to you real quick. It says, let me see. And this is in 1 Kings 19. Don't go there. In verse 8. And he arose and did eat and drink and went in strength of meat to 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mountain of God, Mount Sinai. And he came thither unto the cave. That was the cave of Moses. And he lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him and said unto him, what are you doing here, Elijah? And he said, I have been jealous for thee, and for they have forsaken the covenant and all this kind of stuff. And he says, and then he says, and then, let's see. All right, here we go. In verse 11, and he said, go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord, Mount Sinai, and behold, a strong wind rent the mountains and break it to pieces, and the rocks before the Lord. Somebody kick the AC on. But the Lord, watch this, he was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. Wow, these are all the things that happened on the day of Pentecost, right? Same exact thing. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, right? And the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice. Whisper, whisper, whisper in my ear. Right? So, and it came to pass as they went. That's what you was speaking on? A small voice, that's right. And it came to pass as they still went on and talked that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horses of fire and parted them asunder. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And look what Elisha says. Wow. And Elisha saw it and cried out, my father, my father. He asked for the son, right? When Elijah said, if you see it, you'll have the right to a double portion, right? Yeah. The double portion, only the firstborn got. Right. Elijah saw it and said, daddy, daddy. Right. My father, my father. The chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. So a chariot comes down. When the Lord returns, what he returns on? A horse? Doesn't he come back on a horse? Right? Okay. I just want to make sure that these dots are connecting, right? And the horseman thereof, and he saw him no more, and he took hold of his own clothes and rent them in two pieces. What is that?
Amen.
The what?
Curtain.
Yeah, come on, make the full connection. Hold on. No. This is no. This is all about. Yes, it's all of those things. Watch this. Let me. Maybe you'll catch it on the next one. Come on. Let me give you the next verse, and you'll tie. I'll let you tie it. He rent his clothes. He took up also the mantle of Elijah that fell from him, and went back and stood by the bank of the Jordan. Right? Go ahead. And he took the mantle of Elijah that fell from him, and he smote the waters and said, where is the Lord God of Elijah? And when he had also had smitten the waters, they parted hither and thither. There was a separation. That's a veil. The veil is torn. The way is opened up. For now, Elisha is on coming back into the promised land, Sod. Right? It's opened again. He's receiving the Holy Spirit. He's receiving the mantle of Elijah. He's receiving the covering, the clothes of Elijah. Because when the Lord comes back from you in a moment, a twinkling of an eye, this flesh veil is going to tear open, son, and you're going to receive your robe of righteousness.
Hallelujah.
The mantle of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
You understand that?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Ah! Let's get crazy now. Now we're going to get crazy. So, if this is about the Lord's coming and his return.
Come on, brother.
and our gathering together to be with him on this day, then we should see a battle. After this, we should see something that connects it to that day. What day? The day. The day of the Lord. The day when he comes. The day of his return. The day that Paul spoke of. What day? That notable day when the Lord comes. What day is that? Pentecost. Did you hear me? I'm giving you illuminate was right in front of me. That's the Illuminati eye. I see it, Lord. I see it. I see it. That's what I'm talking about, son. This is the day when fire fell. This is the day when the Spirit of God was given. This is the day you could be filled from the utmost to the topmost. And when the sons of the prophets, which were to view at Jericho, saw him. Remember. Here we go. Remember the tie-in. Let me tie it back in for you. Here goes the tie. The harvest, 49 days. The counting of the Omer. Omar. Harvested 49 souls. On Pentecost, he's 50. Judgment happened to him. Wow. And 50. Pentecost. On Pentecost, 50 and 3 were wounded. Let's see if we can see the 53. Let's go. And when the sons of the prophets, which were to view at Jericho, saw him, they said, the spirit of Elijah doth rest. Doth rest. Rest. See that word, rest? Wow. Remember when Naomi wants to seek rest for Ruth. When Naomi wants to seek rest for Ruth, Boaz was harvesting the barley harvest for 49 days. He was threshing the floor at the barley harvest the next day, early in the morning. It's Pentecost, right? This is when she goes and lays at his feet to the wee hours of the morning, and he says, don't let no one know you're here. He pulled the skirt over the top of her and said, I'm going to do what it is that you require. I'm going to marry you on Pentecost. Only God can do this kind of stuff. There ain't no other book in the world, no other God in the world. That's how come we know that we know that we know that Jesus is the only way.
Amen.
He is the only way. The only way. Let's keep reading because it gets good. The spirit of Elijah doth rest on Elijah. And they came to meet him and bowed themselves. Why are they bowing? They don't want no fire!
Amen.
They don't want the fire! Elijah! Elijah's Jesus! He's full of grace! Mm-hmm. But it's judgment day!
Yeah.
Oh my Lord, son. These 50 were smart! Because the Bible says, let the wheat and the tare grow together. Let the spirit pass over the field, right? All the wheat will humble themselves when they see the spirit and get down. And the only thing that's up is tares. He just gathers them in with a sickle. and throws them where?
Fire.
Pentecost.
Wow.
Wait! Hold on a second. Whisper. That's why I'm reading the word. He starts whispering this stuff. This is new revelation to me this week. I'm just started crying, son. He starts revealing this stuff. Watch this. So, and they said unto him, behold now, there be with thy servants 50 strong men. That's right. One for each day. Let them go, we pray thee, and seek thy master. Lest peradventure the spirit of the Lord that comes down on that day because of 50. Remember, Jesus is connecting this, all of this, hath taken him up and cast him upon some mountain or into some valley. And he said, ye shall not sin. No. Go ahead. And when they urged him till he was ashamed, he said, send. They sent therefore 50, and they sought.
Okay.
53 and 3 days. There's no coincidences in God. There is none.
Amen.
Wait, let's keep going. And they didn't find him. And when they came again to him, you know, when the Lord comes and gets us, we're out of here. Watch this. And when they came again to him, for he tarried at Jericho. He tarried at Jericho. They took Jericho on Pentecost. Jericho means city of palms. That was what was dedicated to God. That Jericho was the first portion of the land. He said, don't take nothing. It all belongs to God. Elisha's name means Yahweh is salvation. That's where he goes, to the house of God. He goes to the house of God. What did you say? Are you with me? The impregnable city of where Rahab was redeemed with the scarlet thread hanging down, right?
Yeah.
Let's go. And when they came, they tarried at Jericho, and he said unto them, did I not say unto you, go not? Come on, watch this. Watch. Amazing. And the men of that city, said unto Elisha, whose name means Jesus, behold, I pray thee. This is the judge. This is Pentecost. I pray thee. The situation of the city is pleasant. That word pleasant means Naomi. We'll go there later. As my Lord seeth, but the water is naught, and the ground is barren. Right? And he said, bring me a new cruse. And he put salt therein. And they brought it to him. And he went forth unto the spring of the waters. And he cast the salt there and said, thus saith the Lord, I have healed these waters. Jesus came down, the Holy Spirit came down on Pentecost, and the waters of the word that brought death, Jesus Christ, through him now brings life. He's the one. He's the healing waters. He healed it. Remember Jesus, here, let me connect these dots for you. Remember, watch this. When they crossed over, and I'm going to make this plain and simple. When they crossed over the Red Sea, and they came to the waters of Meribah, they were bitter. And the tree that was casted in is actually the tree of life. It's symbolic to Christ. Now intermingled with that word, and it became sweet. right? It's the same thing with the little book. And George, now I'm going to explain it so you can better understand what I'm talking about. You see, when they received the word of God, the children of Israel, it was sweet and it was good. And they loved it. And all that you say, we will do. And when they read it and digested it, it became sour and bitter in their stomach because they said, there ain't no way we can do this. That's what it means to be sweet in your mouth and bitter in your stomach. That's why it takes the tree of life, to be casted into it. And then it's sweet in your mouth, sweet in your stomach. And all of a sudden you just start producing fruit. Let me keep going. Watch this. Remember, I said I'm going someplace here with this. Thus saith the Lord. You know, this is all about the Lord's return. Did he not say that, right? So if this is about the Lord's turn and waters are getting healed, doesn't it say something in Zechariah chapter 14 that when the Lord returns, one foot's on this mountain and one foot is over here, and the mountain cleaves in the water, cleaves in the middle, and healing waters flows out of Jerusalem down to Jericho, to the Dead Sea, and makes everything alive again. The waters are healed and the miry places sown.
Amen.
On Pentecost, if I haven't said it. Let's go. Watch, I ain't done yet. Almost, we about there. Come on. So the waters were healed. There's only one person that can heal the waters, man.
Amen.
That's Jesus Christ. So the waters are healed until our day, right now, to this day. Thank you, Jesus. According to the saying of Jesus, which he had spake. Elisha. Elisha's name means Yahweh is salvation. Yeshua's name means salvation. You with me?
Yeah.
All right. Come on. And he went up from thence to the house. And as he was going up by the way, uh-oh. Now let's set this in perspective, because when the Lord returns, the Bible says when he returns, his army is coming with him, right? And he's coming to a certain place for the great battle and all of this stuff, right? Watch this. And when he went up from thence to Bethel, and as he was going up by the way, there came forth little children out of the city. Right? Bethel means house, house of God. Beth is house, El is God. So, and when, now picture this, here's Yeshua's return. And as he was going up by the way, there came forth little children out of the house of God. God calls the children of Israel his children. Out of the city. And they mocked him. Wow. Didn't they do that to Jesus?
Yeah.
Watch this. And said unto him, go up thou, bald head. What does bald head mean? No covering. No covering. Jesus said his father was his covering. He wasn't a Levite. He was of the lion of the tribe of Judah. Go up. Go up, thou old bald head. Go up. Wow, that word go up. And he turned back. It's judgment day, Bubba. And he looked on them and cursed them in the name of Yahweh. And there came forth two she-bears. What did you say? Two bears. 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 Now you might think, oh, I can't even believe Elisha would do such a thing like this. Call out two she-bears to come devour, come on. Two she-bears out of the woods, and they tear right there. 42 children of them. Oh, wow. Is that crazy? This is about his coming. 42. two bears establishes, let it be established that the bear, the Russian bear, Gog and Magog, Tubal, Gog and Magog, Meshach, Tubal, and Rosh, the Russian bear is going to bring judgment on the children of Israel for 42 months, 3.5 years.
Yeah.
Wow. That's what it means. Let me take it a step further. And we read. And he went on from thence to Mount Carmel. Interesting place about Mount Carmel. Mount Carmel is where Elijah rolled the heads of judgment on Judgment Day. On Pentecost, he goes to Mount Carmel where Elijah decapitated, judged the judgment on Baal. Yes, it gets better than that.
Please.
I was there 2006 on May the 13th. I was standing on Mount Carmel. There's a big massive thing, on big massive monument dedicated to Elijah on the top of Mount Carmel. That is what you go to see on top of Mount Carmel. And when you get up on top of Mount Carmel, you know what you're looking at? The Valley of Megiddo, the Battle of Armageddon. Elisha brings you. Not only does he tell you how long the Russian bear is going to judge Israel, just like the Bible says in Ezekiel 38 and 39, and in Revelation, what's coming down the pipe. It's an all foreshadow of what's coming. He actually brings you to the very place where the Battle of Armageddon is going to be. And he's looking out over it. On Pentecost.
Stay right here, Noah.
Mount Carmel. And from thence, he returned to Samaria. You know what's funny about that Samaria word right there? And I close with this. Elisha, why does he go to Samaria? Because Jesus is a Samaritan. Because Jesus is the Samaritan. A Samaritan, he was the good Samaritan in the parable. A Samaritan is half Jew and half Gentile. And in John chapter 8, 48, John chapter 8, verse 48, they literally call Jesus a Samaritan. Art thou not a Samaritan and have a devil? Jesus' mother was Mary and his father was God. Therefore, he was half Jew.
Amen.
And that's why Elisha, who is a picture of Yeshua, he leaves the Valley of Judgment and he goes with his Gentile bride. Ooh. What did you say? Remember the woman at the well? What was the most important thing at the woman at the well? Where's your husband?
Yep.
It's the marriage. What was the important thing about Samaria? Where is your husband? Where is your husband? Where is your husband? What are we talking about Pentecost? Marriage, marriage, marriage. Elisha goes to Samaria. Where's your husband? Where's your husband? Jesus knew. Jesus knew where Elisha went. He knew. He knows the word. He knows what he's got to fulfill. He only does what he sees his father do. So where does he go? He's dealing with his marriage. He goes to Samaria. Woman, where's your husband? That's right. And the one you're with right now, ain't you're not even married to. He ain't even your husband. That's, no coincidence, people. Now Jeroboam, the son of Ahab, began to reign over Israel and Samaria. Check this out. Look. Elisha ends right here. See? Boom. Look at a new beginning. 3:1. Now Jehoram, the son of Ahab, began to reign over Israel in Samaria. You see, it's all about a new beginning. It was a new start. The Word of God is so amazing. And I think we're going to... All right, Peter. Yeah, Tabernacles, the last day. Oh, here you go. I want to give you this. And we're done. I want you to take note of this. No, we're done. Let's pray. I'll save that for next week.